$5.
Good morning. It's good to be together on this rainy day. Our centering thought comes from Mahatma Gandhi. The day the power of love overrules the love of power, the world will know peace. We will now begin.
As they'll remain on through all of December.
Lastly, we started to collect mittens, hats, gloves, and gift cards for Renewal House. And you can bring any donations to the church for December 15th, and we are very grateful for your assistance there. Please look through all the announcements in your order of service, and I invite your others.
Everybody's still standing, and that's great. I mean, we want to first thank everyone for all, everyone that was involved in the fair was able to come. We had a great day. It really was. We're so fortunate we didn't have this rain. It was a wonderful, a great fundraiser. We made just about $5,000, which is our goal. Thank you so much for everybody that was part of it. All the things I wanted to say. But first, I want to thank Maureen King and Kathy Witcher for all of their work. Really an effort. And you can see that everybody did dig into their closets and their attics. And we sold at least half of it, which means that the rest of it is there. So today, please go in. If you want to buy something, if you want to pack up a box, take it home. If you want to pack up boxes and put it in your car, and take it to Savers. The books could all go to the library. Actually, not today, but during the week, they will take them for their friends' book sale. All the linens can be bagged up and put into one of the donation bins of the schools. The schools get money for fabric recycling, so all those things can go there. And so there's still great stuff in there. And there's still some stuff for sale. There's greens and some coleslaw, which is surprising, and some soups. And there's a pot of minestrone heating up on the stove, so everybody's hungry. And if you also, the trading post, if you brought anything electronic, please check to see if it's still there. We'd ask you to take it home so we don't have to pay the spokes of it. There might be a few things left in there. And I want to thank Carrie. I wish she couldn't come today, but there was a whole new lunch group, and they really were having fun. So thanks to everybody. And if you have suggestions for next year, I know we've talked about some, but we're just talking. You know, please send it to me. There's always ways to improve. There's always, I think, our big goal. We have so much that happens here. Our big goal for another year is just get more foot traffic, which means everybody reaching out to everybody they know and how we can get more people here, more people in the door, more people buying stuff. But thank you. It was really a wonderful day for all of us. So thanks a lot.
Thank you.
I light our chalice today in thanksgiving and appreciation for all the efforts of this congregation for the Hobby Fair. And I light our green sanctuary candle for all the ways we strive to be a more sustainable congregation. And with the confession that I used to think the trading source was just a mess, that's all I thought it was. And now I see it as a sustainable way of practicing Christmas for many families. Giving secondhand things is a much better way of celebrating Christmas than buying new. And it's also nice for families to be able to get rid of some toys so they can bring new toys into the home. I now light our Advent candles, and because we're Unitarians, we can do anything we want. We're starting with peace at the beginning of the season, and we're lighting our first candle for peace. Because nothing but peace is enough for me. I heard the bells on Christmas Day, their old familiar carols play, and wild and sweet the words repeat of peace on earth, goodwill to all. And though how as the day had come, the belfries of all Christendom had rolled along the unbroken song of peace on earth, goodwill to all. Till ringing, singing on its way, the world revolved both night and day. A voice, a chime, a chant sublime of peace on earth, goodwill to all. Then from each black accursed mouth, the cannon thundered in the south, and with the sound, the carols drowned of peace on earth, goodwill to all. It was as if the earthquake rent the hearthstones of a continent and made forlorn the household born of peace on earth, goodwill to all. And in despair I bowed my head. There is no peace on earth, I said. For hate is strong and mocks the song of peace on earth, goodwill to all. Then pealed the bells more loud and deep. God is not dead, nor doth he sleep. The wrong shall fail, the right prevail, with peace on earth, goodwill to all. I invite you to join with me in singing our first hymn, number 224 in your great hymnal, Let Christmas Come, number 224 in your great hymnal. Service.
Love is the spirit of this church, and service is its law. To dwell together in peace, to seek the truth in freedom, to serve humanity in love is our covenant with each other and with God. You may be seated.
An offering to support and sustain the ministries of this church will now be given and gratefully received. Still, and what I'm talking about is finding a way to keep your whole body still So I have some suggestions. Have you ever tried to be like a rock? Let's see if we can try that, all of us. Let's try being like a rock. You have to be as still as a rock. Well, okay, we're humans, we have to breathe still, sorry. And we have to live. Yeah, Sam, we have to live. Okay, maybe a rock isn't the best thing. What if we try being like a tree? Can we try being like a tree? You guys can stand up. What would a tree do? Like, it's waving a little bit? Yeah, Maggie's got it. She's got her branches out. And she's waving like a tree. Nice. Can be like a tree. Maybe there's a little wind. I like that. PJ? I like that. A tree in the winter. PJ's a tree in the winter with no branches and no leaves. Oh, Sam's a dead tree. Wait, sometimes, how does that make you feel to be like a tree, Maggie? She says a thumbs up. How does that make you feel when you're going to be like a tree? Nothing? You feel nothing? That's sort of like finding a stillness is feeling nothing. What else? So I think it's really important for us to find peace in our days, to find a way to calm down. That's why we ring the bell before we start talking to help you listen, but sometimes we also need to do that when we're at home. Do you ever find yourself getting upset? Do you ever get upset? Yeah? What if you, when you start feeling upset, you actually sit down and you pretend to be a rock, or you pretend to be a tree for just a minute, instead of lashing out, you just start by like taking a deep breath. Have your parents ever asked you to take a time out? Yeah, when my parents used to, and I, they did it a lot, ask me to take time outs, I would cry. My mother used to make me sit on the steps, and I had to sit on whatever step I was old, because she thought if I got to my bedroom, I would forget why I was timed out. So she would make me just go there, like, if I was five, I was on the fifth step, if I was six, I was on the sixth step, be a teacher. Well, we had 14 steps, and even up until I was 14, I was having to sit on the steps. And what I learned was that over time, if I could use the timeout as like a real timeout and not get upset about it, I would just say, this is my chance to take a deep breath. This is my chance to be like a tree and breathe and just calm my spirit and find a little peace. Then when I came back and talked to my mom, even if I was still upset, I could talk to her more calmly and she could hear what I had to say instead of me being angry, right? Because that's what usually happens if I'm too stirred up as I talk angrily. So what I'm saying is maybe you could find to be like a rock or a tree when you're feeling anxious. And Christmas sometimes just feels chaotic, doesn't it? You're unwrapping presents as Santa comes.
And
oh, and you have to get presents, which you're going to get to do today. But if you remember not to let it be chaos, let it be some calm in the middle of that chaos, just take a breath. It'll be a lot more fun, I promise. All right? So I want you to think about that while we see you in your classes. All right? And we have a line leader, is Simon. So we'll start seeing you in your classes. Breathing in peace.
Let us be grateful for all the silences in our lives, for with them we may more completely experience sound.
As a chronic multitasker, I have to admit, my first time reading this morning was when I was rushing it. That makes sense when I get through this. Brushing Your Teeth by Thich Nhat Hanh. Here's a challenge for you. You're going to spend 1 to 2 minutes brushing your teeth. How can you do it so that you really have happiness throughout a brief couple of minutes? Don't rush. Don't try to brush your teeth as quickly as possible and be done with it. Focus all your attention on your brushing. You have the time to brush your teeth. You have a toothbrush, toothpaste, and teeth brush. I'm 84 years old, and every time I brush my teeth, I always feel happy. You know, at my age, still having all these teeth brushed is a wonderful thing. So the challenge is to brush your teeth in such a way that you have that ease and happiness during the whole 1 to 2 minutes of brushing. If you can do that, you've succeeded. You're meditating right there. Here's a poem you can enjoy while brushing your teeth. Brushing my teeth and rinsing my mouth, I vow to speak purely and lovingly. When my mouth is fragrant and ripe with speech, a flower will bloom in the garden of my heart. The verses are meant to help us bring our awareness back to what's happening in the present moment. We don't get caught in reciting the lines. If we already have mindfulness and concentration, if we really know how to dwell peacefully in the present moment already, we may be just happy, not using them at all.
Thank you.
Invite you to sing with me hymn number 100 in your gray hymnal, and number 100, I've Got Peace Like a River.
Thank you.
marks a very special occasion in this beloved community. It's not just any Sunday. It's not just the first Sunday in Advent where we celebrate peace, but it all is also the completion of our Holly Fair. Do you know how long the Holly Fair has been going on? I told some of you yesterday. It's been going on since 1900. That makes it 123 years old. To the Holly Fair to celebrate the season. In the past, it was also a fundraiser. It was run by the Women's Alliance. It initially took place on a Thursday when people didn't really work during the week like we do, with a fancy lunch and dinner. It has always taken over a month to plan. This hasn't changed at all. Obviously, food, even if we don't provide dinner, has played a significant part in the Holly Fair. I think a lot of people walked home with the dinner, even if they didn't have it. As your minister, I've noticed that the Holly Fair can be both stressful and sublime. This is the first time I have hardly lifted a finger to make the Holly Fair happen. So I will confess to feeling more peace than rancor at this time. The Holly Fair is more of a community builder than a fundraiser. Even though we did come $152.50 short of our $5,000 goal. Just as the parish players are more of a community builder than a show. And so on this first Sunday in the season of Advent, we will consider peace. And I wonder how we can bring peace into all of our doing and really give peace a chance. As your man, Longfellow's poem, I Heard the Bells on Christmas Day, speaks to the enduring struggle for peace and amid a turn of the tumultuous realities of life. In his case, it was the Civil War. The poet reflects on the dissonance between the joyous bells of Christmas Day and the harsh sounds of war and division in a country that he loved. And yet through it all, Longfellow finds a glimmer of hope, a call to give peace a chance. Longfellow, a Unitarian who attended the first parish in Portland, Maine, wrote this poem after hearing that his oldest child, Charles, had been shot during the Civil War. He originally was told that Charles was shot in the face, but that wasn't true. He was shot in the shoulder. Longfellow's wife had recently died, just barely 2 years earlier, when her dress caught fire. And Henry Wadsworth Longfellow was severely burned himself and just recently recovered as he tried to put out his wife's burning dress. Hearing the news that his eldest son was shot and not likely to survive was when he wrote this poem. He didn't know what would happen when he chose peace instead of rancor and division. Charlie Longfellow did survive, it turns out. He was unable to return to the military after his injuries in the war, and he became an avid yachter, traveling between 1875 and 1891 to Cuba, Mexico, Scotland, Ireland, the Canary Islands, Madeira, Italy, North Africa, Turkey, France, the West Indies, Egypt, Scandinavia, Spain, Portugal, Wales, Colombia, Australia, and returning several times to England and Japan. Longfellow's son was deeply interested in other cultures and wanted to experience his surroundings rather than just observe them. Charlie Longfellow clearly lived his best life rather than, even after his accident, rather than sitting in his loss. In our lives, We too often encounter discord, loss, whether on a personal or global scale, and only sometimes do we see a brighter day beyond our heartbreak and frustration. The noise of conflict can drown out the melodies of peace and healing. Longfellow's message reminds us, even in our darkest moments, we can choose to hear the bells of peace. It is a call to action, an invitation to embrace the possibility of harmony and reconciliation, even when everything around you tells you that might not be possible. This is why I often chose to stand on the side of peace and love with like-minded others. 2 weeks ago, I went to Malden to stand before Whip Clark's office and asked her to stand for peace in the Middle East. I am not her constituent, but I was standing in solidarity with colleagues who had been denied the opportunity to talk to their representative about their concerns about her stance and the financial support and aid to Israel. Speaking to our representatives about our concerns is part of exercising our democratic rights, which is part of our principles and purposes. Supporting others to do so is part of living my UU principles. As Unitarian Universalists, we're also called to be ambassadors of peace, not just during festive times like Advent, but every day, even in the face of war and loss. Longfellow's words echo our UU beliefs, emphasizing our shared responsibility to nurture a world where peace will prevail, even if I don't get to see it in my lifetime. While reading Gandhi's autobiography, I remember I was struck by his ability to temper his reactions as the keystone to change in the world. For example, when he wanted to curb the violence in his country, he realized he had to cure the violence in his own home, in his own heart, first. I've often had similar thoughts leaving UU meetings where people were argumentative and contentious, which some UUs, not here, of course, but other places, believe is their responsibility to be cantankerous, right? And then hearing on the radio the way the legislature is arguing and contentious, and I wondered, how can we expect our legislature to do it differently if we ourselves cannot do it differently? Thich Nhat Hanh offers guidance on cultivating peace in our daily lives, and peace is every breath. He emphasizes the transformative power of mindfulness. He encourages us to be fully present in each moment, breathing in peace and exhaling compassion and love. Consider the simple act of brushing your teeth. In the rush of our daily routines, we often neglect the potential for mindfulness in such mundane tasks. Thich Nhat Hanh suggests that we can turn these moments into opportunities for mindfulness and peace by being fully present and feeling the brush against our teeth, tasting the toothpaste, and being aware of our breath. We transform our routine into a conscious and peaceful moment. Yoga practice teaches that examining all our routine daily tasks and even our pent-up relations as rituals of movement can open us to increase mindfulness in our daily lives. When we stretch or yawn, just as when we eat or brush our teeth, we can awaken mindfully to our daily lives, bringing us more peace. Through mindfulness, we learn to appreciate the interconnectedness of all things. Each breath becomes a reminder of our shared humanity. In this way, we give peace a chance. In grand gestures and in small, intentional moments that shape our daily existence. I'm thinking about small, intentional moments and how they shape our daily existence, I wondered how often the 50s housewife exemplified not only a husband-pleasing cow-tower, but also a conscious, intentional, good-natured spouse. In full confession, I have rejected being a Wilma Flintstone to a Fred most of my life. This is why it took me until I was 49 to get married to Jenny. Even longer to greet her at the door with a smile or look up from what I was doing. In fact, it took me until last week when I started thinking about this. Because I always saw Wilma Flintstone greeting the grumbling, hot-headed Fred at the door with a smile and calm response to whatever his mood to be as being overly obsequious. And up until this last week, through 9 years of our marriage, I often refused to interrupt what I was doing to greet Jenny at the door or even look up from what I was doing to give her a smile. Ask her how her day was doing, how her day was. Saying this to all of you sounds ridiculous to me now, of course. Who wouldn't want to be greeted at the door with a smile when they come in? My only excuse is that I unconsciously greeted her each day instead of consciously greeting her each day. In light of my sermon this week on peace, I started to greet Jenny each morning and afternoon in this way. It brought more peace to our relationship this week. Do you agree? Yeah. And this included simple acts of just getting her a cup of coffee when I let the dog out, or smiling and asking her how she slept. And it changed my sense of how my day was going to be. Changing my behavior immediately changed my sense of connectedness to my spouse. In hindsight, this is all Wilma Flintstone and most 50s housewives were doing when they greeted their spouse at the door, dressed to the nines, with something baking in the oven, consciously carving out a peaceful home atmosphere, setting the space differently. And by deliberately offering others the welcome every person deserves, we will also find that same welcome reflected back to us. The same reciprocal feeling of peace is given, received, and returned when we strive to be more conscious in our interactions. I knew that to be true everywhere but at home, but now I know it's true at home too. In his book, A Hidden Wholeness, Parker Palmer delves into the importance of silence in nurturing the soul. He explores the idea that the soul loves silence and craves moments of stillness and contemplation amidst the world's noise. Palmer argues that it is in our silence that we can tap into the inner wisdom and connect with our authentic selves. And I would argue that it is our authentic selves where we find peace. As Unitarian Universalists, our commitment to a free and responsible search where truth and meaning aligns with Palmer's insights. In the silence, we find a space for reflection, for self-discovery. In these moments, we connect with the deepest parts of ourselves, and in turn, we find the shared humanity that binds us all. Peace is not merely the absence of noise, but a profound presence in each moment, is a canvas upon which we can paint
calm or chaos. Giving peace a chance requires us to embrace the silence, the pause, the breath, to create space where the soul can unfold with the true purpose of peace and love. Giving peace a chance is an active endeavor that requires us to embody peace and interact intentionally with others. Let us commit to being ambassadors of peace in our families, in our workplaces, in our communities. Let us approach conflict with open hearts and minds, seeking to understand rather than divide. Longfellow's bells still ring, calling us to action, and Thich Nhat Hanh's mindful breathing guides us through each step. The spirit of Parker Palmer's insights let us create spaces for contemplation and introspection and finding peace in our own hearts. In these moments, we may find the strength to navigate the world's complexity with compassion and peace, hoping that by doing so, we may bring more peace into the world. We won't know until this story is over. And we continue exploring this rich tapestry of our Yunu faith. May we always strive to give peace a chance in our hearts, in our actions, in the world we collectively crave. The bells of peace are ringing. Let us listen, breathe, and embrace the hidden wholeness within us all.
Thank you.
take this light of peace and carry it with us through our week, through our month, through our year, into the lives of all people that we meet.